I know that a lot of us, though, were hoping that the Mueller report was going to come out. Trump was going to get into trouble. But do you think that we spent too much time on that? You know, everybody kind of in the Mueller mania, afterwards kind of disappointed.
Yeah, I mean, we relied on it. I certainly did. I thought that was going to be the end of this chapter, and it turns out there's just going to be more and more corruption. But you know, listen, I had to get my life back.
Yes.
You know what I mean? I want to be optimistic and I want to be positive. And I can't watch the news on a loop like I used to, and I can't read the news on a loop like I used to, because I want to be in a state of action, not reaction.
Yeah.
And sometimes when we're watching it, we're just sitting there going, ugh, I hate this, I can't believe it. So I think a lot of us, you know, have had a wake-up call, and I know I'm a person that happened to, and I know millions of other people feel the same way. So it was a good chance to take a look at myself and find out what my issues are moving forward, and why Trump represents such pandemonium to me.
Yeah, yeah, that's one of the things about this book. This is a different kind of a book. I mean, it's still hilarious, but you're really kind of opening up your heart. Why did the Trump election hit you so hard?
I think through therapy, I had to get a psychiatrist after the election. So Republicans love to talk about that. Chelsea Handler is such a spoiled brat. And I was acting like a spoiled brat. I didn't understand that things could go this wrong. I thought adults were supposed to take care of these, you know, adults like you, responsible people, so that I could go on living in my blissful kind of uninformed happiness, you know, cashing checks and being a loudmouth. I was like, oh, this is great.
Yeah.
It was a wake-up call, because it represented to me, vis-a-vis my psychiatrist, I realized that it was a trigger for me. It was a trigger for me to the other time in my life when things were unstable, and when things and my life became unhinged, so to speak, when my brother died.
You were 9 years old.
I was 9. My brother was 22, and he went on a hike. He sat in the kitchen and said to me, I'll be home. I'll never leave you with these people talking about my parents. And I trusted him, and he was my first kind of boyfriend. You know, when you're a little girl, your big brother's everything. And for me, that's who he was. So he died after he told me that. And I never thought I had to revisit that. I never thought that's where my anger was from. It is.
Yeah.
That's where my anger is from, because I felt rejected. And at that age, you don't have the articulation.
You can't make sense of when you're a kid.
You don't know what happened. You just feel like he left you and he lied to you. And so that was my way to go through life. Like, I don't need anyone. I will not rely on adults. They're unreliable. And it's not about Trump. Mm-hmm. Trump represents to me that period of time where the unjustness of it all.
But I mean, I just think that the courage to just say that just needs a beat. Because I think a lot of people got triggered and regressed back to earlier things, and then acted out of that for a very long time and are still in that. You're the first person I've heard to actually put words to that and to write it in a book that's both funny and, you know, heartbreaking. Talk more about that discovery.
I think what I learned was that we all have, I mean, part of the human experience is that you're injured. You have trauma. That's happened to every single person, whether you're aware of it or not, or what your trauma is or how great it is different. But I think, you know, when you don't wring out an injury, when you don't go through it and walk the walk and talk to somebody about a pain, about grief, about a loss, it will come back and bite you in the ass. It will land on your door bigger and louder, and the hole gets bigger. And then it is an injury that really needs attention. And I think for me, you know, a lot of us have such built up and pent up anger from something that happened in our childhood. It's natural to be angry at Donald Trump being president.
Right.
It is not natural for it to take over and consume my life.
Yeah. I mean, listen, I've been saying it a long time. It's bad enough that Trump runs the White House. He shouldn't run my house. Like, I need to be able to have some kind of peace. But, you know, when you decided to write this book, what was that process like? Because you're going through it while you're writing it, it seems to me.
Yeah, I mean, I started going to sessions with my guy, and he was telling me things about why. I said, why do I end relationships if somebody pisses me off? I can't ever speak to them again. It's like scorched earth. It's over. And he said, because that's your blueprint for how a relationship ends. Because your brother said goodbye.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you know, said he was coming. He was there today, one day, and gone the next day. So that's how you think it goes. And I was like, oh. So, like, things like that I was like, I can't be the only person who's this out of touch with themselves. So I wrote, you know, writing it all, it was a huge catharsis, obviously, because I got to talk about my mother dying and my brother dying. And I was like, I can't write a book about death. This is going to be awful. Who's going to buy this book?
But it's really powerful and funny.
And death is, it can be funny. You know what I mean? If we stop resisting so much when people are leaving us or sick, and just help them through their pain and help them be comfortable. Like, it's a whole different world. We take everything so personally. Loss is so personal. The person died. Like, it's not no one's out to get you and die on you.
Right.
No one's trying to disappoint you in that way.
Yeah.
So we just, I helped me slow down, which is something I really needed. It helped me sit with myself and think about everything and what I want to contribute in this world moving forward.
Speaking of contribute, you actually went out with Emily's List and you tried to help people get elected to office, women in particular. What did you learn about the country that you didn't know when you went out there trying to help people get elected?
How easy it is to run for office. I mean, it's so much easier than people think it is. And then it's just like a galvanization. You know, you get momentum and you build it and you catch people with you. And there's so much energy in it. So it's a great thing. I know you know this, to be part of something like that.
That's really cool.
So I think lots of people said, we're going to chip in for this election. And look at the results. I mean, look how many women and people of color we elected to Congress. I mean, it's a huge, huge victory.
Absolutely. Speaking of women, we also now have a ton of women running to be president. Do you think it's important that we have a woman at the top of the ticket?
I don't know about the top of the ticket. You know, I think we have to have a woman on the ticket. It depends who the best person is. I don't want to say put a woman in a job because we need a woman. We need a woman representing, and we have qualified women who clearly can do that. I love Elizabeth Warren, and I love Pete Buttigieg, or however, Boca Raton, however you say it. I love a lot of the candidates, and I'm also happy that there are so many. Good. Yeah. Let's get them all.
Get them all.
You know what I mean?